Good afternoon, colleagues. I have to remind members that social distancing measures are in place in the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus, and I ask members that they take care to observe these measures, including when entering and exiting the Chamber. Please only use the aisles and walkways to access your seat and when moving around the Chamber. The first item of business is portfolio questions, and the portfolio of this today is health and social care. I would ask any member wishing to request a supplementary question to press their request to speak button or indicate in the chat function by entering the letter R during the relevant question. I would also say the plea that is always made that to get as many people in as possible, it would be really appreciated if the questions could be short and succinct and the answers as well. Thank you. So, the question number one has been withdrawn. Question number two, Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to support and improve child mental health services.
Minister Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I welcome Ms Gallagher to Parliament. We are undertaking a number of measures to improve child mental health services, and are determined to address the significant impact that the COVID-19 period has had on the mental well-being of children and young people. In October 2020, we published Mental Health Transition and Recovery Plan in response to the mental health effects of the COVID-19 pandemic. The plan contains a number of actions targeted at supporting children and young people and is supported by the £120 million Mental Health Recovery and Renewal Fund announced in February of this year. Specifically, this work includes actions to improve specialist CAM services, address waiting times, and improve other mental health supports and services for children and young people. We recognise that not all children and young people need specialist services like CAMHS, so we have provided £15 million of additional funding to local authorities to deliver locally based mental health and wellbeing support for 5 to 24-year-olds in their communities. And we continue to invest in a range of other measures to support children and young people's mental wellbeing. This includes providing enhanced digital resources on mental health and wellbeing available via Young Scots website and expansion of the Distress Brief Intervention Programme to under-16s.
Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I also thank the Minister for his answer. But can I ask a question on a more specific point? When will the Scottish Government deliver their manifesto commitment to introduce a national transition strategy to improve outcomes for children and young people experiencing mental health and their transitions to adulthood?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, as Ms Gallagher in the Chamber know, I am very new to this post. What I am doing at this moment in time is looking at all aspects of our mental health delivery, in particular with a focus on young people. I've already spoken to health boards around about this, including NHS Grampian and NHS Lothian, and I will continue to engage with boards and other partners and stakeholders to ensure that we get this right for children and young people in Scotland.
Karen Mulhan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask, the damning order of CAM services in 2018 called for an end to rejected referrals, and 3 years on, at least 20% of referrals to CAMs are still consistently rejected. Having waited 3 years, why have the government failed to end this damaging practice, and when will the reform the referral system, as campaigners have been asking over the last 3 years?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Government accepted all of the recommendations in the 2018 audit of rejected referrals report. And we have worked to implement the recommendations by introducing a CAM service level specification, which sets out the levels of service that children, young people and families can expect from CAMs across Scotland. We have agreed additional NHS board allocations of £29.2 million in 21-22 in order to deliver improvements to CAMs and to address waiting list backlogs. Obviously, COVID has had an impact on service delivery here. Some boards have done better than others in continuing to see patients over the course of the pandemic period. I want to ensure that the best practice that is in place in many areas are exported to all of the boards in Scotland in order to ensure that we get this right for everyone in our country.
Question number three, Michelle Thompson.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the Life Search Health, Wealth and Happiness Report of 2020 to 2021.
Cabinet Secretary Marie Todd. I'm sorry, Minister Marie Todd. Bring my promotion there.
Hello, a wee promotion. Thank you, Presiding Officer. We welcome the Health, Wealth and Happiness Research for 2020-21. We have a range of research activity to understand the complex impacts of the pandemic on society which align with these findings. For example, we know that the pandemic has had a negative impact on many people's mental health and well-being, and we're committed to providing clear, comprehensive and accessible support. Our Clear Your Head website contains a variety of resources and tips to help people to take care of their mental health and well-being, including the benefits of physical activity and healthy diet. For those who need more support, we expanded the NHS 24 Mental Health Hub so that it's now available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
Michelle Thompson.
I thank the Minister for that response. As she correctly states, volunteer groups, charities and organisations such as Falkirk District Association for Mental Health, or FDAMH, provide vital independent support within our communities. And their work does indeed often complement and support the work of our NHS mental health services. The recent Life Research report, however, shows that 44% of all Scottish adults are less happy now than before the start of the pandemic, with COVID-related fears, including financial health and further lockdowns, dominating the list of future worries. I have a simple question. Would it be possible to outline what support the Scottish Government will be making available to organisations like FDAMH to help them rise to the challenge of further supporting our communities whilst we face the uncertainties of transitioning back into a normal life as possible?
Minister.
Thank you. There's been a range of work over the last year to support community organisations with additional pressures as a result of COVID-19, including through the Community and Third Sector Recovery Programme and the Communities Recovery Fund. In February, we announced an additional £120 million for a Recovery and Renewable Fund to ensure delivery of the commitment set out in our Mental Health Transition and Recovery Plan. And as part of that, we plan to invest in community support services with a focus on prevention and community wellbeing and promoting the capacity and role of third sector organisations to deliver this.
Thank you, Minister. Moving to question four, Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its treatment plans for people with long COVID.
Cabinet Secretary Hamza Youssef.
It is crucial that our decisions are based on the latest available evidence and indeed, of course, clinical guidance. Our approach is for people to have access to the support they need for assessments, for diagnosis, for care and, importantly, for rehabilitation in a setting that is as close to their home as is possible. NHS boards right across Scotland are coordinating and providing local pathways to ensure a multidisciplinary approach and a person-centred approach in their local area. Additionally, we invested over £460,000 in Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland to enable them to deliver long COVID support service, which complements the support being provided by NHS Scotland.
Fulton MacGregor.
Thanks, Presiding Officer, and I welcome that answer from the Cabinet Secretary and the work that's been done. I've got a constituent who's continuing to struggle with long COVID, and he's raised the issue with me of a Scottish National Register for long COVID patients. Can I ask if this is something that the Government will consider? He's also raised with me several times the issue of COVID clinics, such as those that are in England. So can I also ask if this is something that the Government are still looking into?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, happy to consider the issue of the register, and the issue of clinics is not one that we've ever ruled off the table. If Fulton MacGregor, I'm sure, was listening and watching First Minister's questions, you would have heard the First Minister address this very point. I can understand why members may ask for the establishment of long COVID clinics here in Scotland. What I would say is it's important that we understand as much about long COVID as possible before we do that. It's also clear that one size does not necessarily fit all. So just because an approach works or is being implemented in one part of the UK, we can't just supplant that here in Scotland. So what we are doing and what we have invested in is that multi-agency, multidisciplinary approach, using both primary care and secondary care, but ensuring that that support, that rehabilitation, that care that an individual needs is as close to their home setting as is possible. But I'll continue conversations with those across political parties, but importantly with clinicians, to see how we can tackle this this condition that we're obviously still learning more about.
Dr. Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I heard the response to the long COVID question at FMQs and by the Cabinet Secretary just now, and I have to say I am disappointed. GPs are under tremendous strain and pressure and simply cannot cope with long COVID in our 10-minute appointment slots. I've spoken in the press and in this very chamber about its devastating effects on my patients. The research the First Minister spoke of will take 2 to 3 years to come back and is too long for my patients. So will the Cabinet Secretary please meet with me and engage on giving new money for new long COVID clinics using models that already exist and that we have adapted to suit all of Scotland, not just the Central Belt, to give these patients hope and declaration of interest. I am a practicing doctor.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm of course happy to meet with Dr. Gohani and give that commitment to do so. What I would say is take some exception to one or two characterisations. I don't accept that it's simply GPs that are picking up the burden. They of course are undoubtedly doing a portion of that, but the point of the multidisciplinary support is that we try to provide holistic support. So that's supported by a range of NHS services such as wider primary care teams, occupational therapists, physiotherapists, speech and language therapy, and indeed others. But we've published the implementation support note, which again gives details of the pathway, not just through primary care, but into secondary care too. What I would say is I was looking at some of the detail around the long COVID clinics in England, and of course I'm happy to take this up with the member, but I noticed that in the evaluation that was published on the 13th of May by the Peer Support and Advocacy Group, Long COVID Support, it found for those respondents that were seeking a referral to long COVID clinics that less than 30% were satisfied with the experience. And indeed, some of those who were waiting for a referral had been waiting for as long as 127 days. So it's not a case that simply because something is being implemented in England that we can just supplant that and bring that here to Scotland. If he does have ideas, which from his question he clearly does, about how we may be able to adapt some of the good practice in any part of the UK, I'm more than willing to meet with him and listen to that and engage in that respect.
Jackie Bailey.
Cabinet Secretary will know I asked the First Minister about long COVID clinics earlier today. Her response was pretty identical to a response I received 8 months ago. And the Cabinet Secretary's response just now doesn't actually reflect the experience of people on the ground. I entirely accept that we need holistic support, but at the moment there is little to no support at all for constituents in my area. People are suffering from long COVID and they need help now, not at some point in the future. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell me what he can do to speed up the establishment of specialist clinics?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I would say to Ms Bailey again that I would disagree with some of the characterisation of her question. To suggest that they don't have any support whatsoever does a disservice to the support that they're being provided by GPs, by other primary care health givers, by secondary care health givers. So it's not a case that long COVID, those individuals with long COVID, if Miss Bailey would listen as opposed to shouting to me from a sedentary position, she might actually be able to engage better in the issue, because it's not the case that they're not getting any support whatsoever. In terms of specialist clinics, I've just read some lived experience and some of the feedback from those with long COVID in England, who again were not satisfied, over 70%. Not satisfied with what they've been receiving, the support they've been receiving or not receiving from long COVID clinics in England and Wales. So I will, of course, engage with Ms Bailey. I have already engaged with her on occasion. I will engage with her continually throughout the period. I'm happy to have that conversation with her about what more support we can provide. But I'm afraid it's not simply as simple as saying that we can just supplant a model that is in England up here in Scotland. We must take into account the unique geography of our country, of course, the unique healthcare setup of our NHS here in Scotland. But I am convinced that we can and should engage in this matter to see what more support we can provide for those that are suffering from long COVID.
Question number 5, Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. to ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to support unpaid carers.
Minister Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I welcome Jenny Minto to Parliament, and can I extend an apology to Ms Mohan, because I should have welcomed her earlier as well. Presiding Officer, we fund coordination of Carers Week in Scotland to highlight carers' immense contribution to our society and the extra pressures many have faced during the pandemic. During the pandemic, we have invested an additional £1.9 million in extra carer support via carer organisations. We're committed to ensuring carers' rights under the Carers Act, deliver real change for carers, including through the extra £28.5 million for local carer support in this year's budget. And we will engage with carers as we deliver on our commitment to establish a national care service which provides better support for unpaid carers. We've also invested around £358 million in carers' allowance and carers' allowance supplement in 2020-21 and over £860,000 in Young Carers Grant between the 21st of October 2019 and the 31st of January this year. Young carers can also benefit from the Young Scot Young Carers package that provides non-cash benefits to young carers aged 11 to 18. And we will shortly bring forward legislation to make a further coronavirus carers allowance supplement payment in December this year. This is in addition to the increased payment made to carers who qualified for carers allowance on the 13th of April 2020. This means eligible carers north of the border continue to receive more than those south of the border, and our discussion paper published in March this year sets out our draft aims for Scottish carers' assistance, and we are developing options to ensure a replacement for carers' allowance delivers for unpaid carers in Scotland. A lot going on, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. Hopefully the next answer could perhaps paraphrase some of the activity. Jenny Minto.
I'd like to thank the Minister for that very detailed answer. In Argyll and Bute, third sector organisations such as DOCHIS provide fantastic support to unpaid carers. Organisations like this were delighted with the Carers' Rights Act 2018, yet investment in these organisations do not cover costs. Can the Minister outline what support is available for organisations that support unpaid carers, and will the Scottish Government consider the views of such organisations as part of the consultation process for the National Care Service?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I absolutely agree with Ms Minto that local carer support organisations like DOCHIS Carer Centre do a fantastic job for carers, and they have responded amazingly to very difficult circumstances during the course of the pandemic. These services, Presiding Officer, are commissioned by local authorities and integration authorities to provide advice and support for carers under the Carers Act. The additional £28.5 million for local carer support in this year's budget brings the Total Carers Act uplift in the local government settlement since the Act took effect in 2018 to £6 to £8 million per year. And we also fund the national carer organisations to help carer centres share approaches and learn from each other. I can say to the Chamber, Presiding Officer, that in designing the National Care Service, we will work with carers, people needing support, and with the organisations who commission and provide care to ensure that the new service delivers the improvements that we want to see in people's lives.
Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I would draw members' attention to my register of interest as a former employee of Enable Scotland. Unpaid carers have been struggling through lockdown through lack of respite because of other supports being withdrawn, and indeed Enable Scotland have heard from carers who have only managed to get any respite at all when they were hospitalised themselves. That is quite frankly shocking. So beyond warm words in Carers Week on respite, can the Minister advise what is being done additionally in terms of additional respite hours for carers, and does he agree with me that we need a new comprehensive support strategy as outlined in Scottish Labour's Carers Manifesto, including a right to respite?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I should say to the Chamber that under protection levels 0 to 3, day centres and residential respite services can operate in line with the relevant guidance. I know that in some areas that is not happening as fast as others, and I've written to local authorities and to health and social care partnerships in this past week to try and get things moving there, and Mr O'Kane can be assured that while I will continue to do my level best to ensure that that day respite is there for carers. Beyond that, Presiding Officer, we are working with carer organisations and others on our forthcoming £1.4 million holiday voucher scheme to benefit carers, people with disabilities and families on low incomes. I'm more than happy to have further discussions with Mr O'Kane on this issue because, like him and many others in the Chamber, we need to get back to some kind of normality and allow folk to get the break that many so desperately need.
Question number 6 was not lodged. Question number 7, Christine Graham. Christine Graham, maybe try another consult? Or? Could maybe Christine Graham try the seat across the aisle from the one she's currently at, being advised by the clerks? Should I move?
Oh, it's on, it's come on.
Question number 7,
apologies.
Thank you.
My apologies, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thank you for your tolerance. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will review the efficacy of both the NHS COVID-19 vaccination helpline and the missed appointment system.
Cabinet Secretary.
In the interest of brevity, yes, we will do that, of course. I should say that I would like to take this opportunity to thank everybody involved in the vaccination programme, including those that are often in the end of the telephone helpline. The helpline averages around 17,000 calls per day. They do an excellent job. But yes, of course, we will continue to keep that helpline and indeed the missed appointment system under review.
Christine Graham.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response. With reference to the vaccination programme, I understand that the cohort of 18 to 29-year-olds next to be vaccinated, you must be 18 by or on the 17th of May 21. Can I ask how those who attain 18 years after that date will be contacted for vaccination, especially as many of them will be returning to college and university?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Christine Graham for an important question. For those 18 to 29-year-olds, who are eligible to register on the online portal, you have till tomorrow to do so. So I would urge as many of them as possible to do so. That will allow you to receive your appointment details by text or by email. In fact, a number of those appointments have already have gone out of the system. For those that fall into the cohort that Christine Graham mentions, if you do not register on the portal, you will still get a letter, as you can imagine. So nobody in that cohort, 18 to 29-year-old, will be missed out. And if you want to change the health board area for which when you would like that appointment letter to go to, then you can do that by calling the helpline.
Question number 8, Jackson Carlow.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the research led by Newcastle University and published in The Lancet into outcomes for arising from minimum unit pricing.
Minister Marie Todd.
I welcome the findings of the research led by Newcastle University, which conclude that minimum unit pricing is an effective policy option to reduce off-trade purchases of alcohol. This is consistent with findings from the comprehensive evaluation Public Health Scotland are leading on. We've always believed that this policy would reduce alcohol sales, and we have early encouraging signs that this is now feeding through to reduced harms. Alcohol-specific deaths for 2019 were 10% less than the previous year, a notable reduction that's only happened on a handful of occasions since 1979. I understand the member has been keen to see positive results from the introduction of minimum unit pricing, and I trust these findings are also welcomed by him.
Jackson Carlow.
I can confirm to the Minister that they are, and obviously vindicate the decision of those of us who supported the policy from from its inception. However, in the report, there was one caveat that is a cause for concern reported in the Scotsman and elsewhere, and that the exception to this was those in high-purchasing, low-income homes who did not seem to change their habits. One of the study's authors, Professor Eileen Kaner from the University, who is also Director of Applied Research Collaboration, said it was concern that households did not adjust their buying habits and spending simply increased as a result of the MUP policy. Now, this was always a concern. If low-income households have simply increased their spend on alcohol from fixed incomes, that is at the expense of other things and consequential, considerable long-term harms. So I wonder what the response of the Scottish Government is to that and whether there's anything further that can be done, and also whether, in fact, the Scottish Government intends to review the level of minimum unit pricing at some point in the near future.
Thank you. Minister, briefly, please.
Thank you. The minimum unit pricing targets those that drink the most and will impact on all income groups. Those that drink the most will spend the most on alcohol, and this study showed that minimum unit pricing was well targeted at those who purchase the most alcohol. Low-income houses, households, you're absolutely correct, that purchased high amounts of alcohol didn't seem to reduce the amount of alcohol that they purchased, and their expenditure on alcohol increased. But that wasn't the same for the next lowest income group. And obviously, low-income households that purchased only small amounts of alcohol didn't increase their expenditure when the minimum unit pricing was introduced. There will be a thorough evaluation of minimum unit pricing as we make a decision. As you know, there's a sunset clause in the legislation, so we will only continue the legislation if the Parliament votes for it. And I will confirm that we will be looking at the whole the level of pricing for each unit between now and when that occurs.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions. I'll just give a moment's pause to allow time for the front bench to change seats. Thank you.